Hello, Crossing School. Okay, welcome to Monday, March 4th, family time and personal finance. Let me tell you what's going on and why we're doing this. I probably told you, I had foot surgery Friday morning. Everything went well. Stopped at Chick-fil-A on the way home and talked to the staff about, because I really can't walk or drive or anything like that for a little while. So we thought we might make a video, and it turns out that the topic for this week's personal finance dovetails perfectly with our topic for this week's family time. So we're going to kind of combine them. I think it's a very important topic. I think it's something that's going to be immediately useful for you and useful over the next 5, 10, 20 years, whatever. So anyway, let's go ahead and get started. The topic for this week's family time is, don't be that guy. Don't be that guy. And this week, or today, we're going to talk about don't be that guy in terms of cybersecurity. And I'm going to guess most of the people watching this have a cell phone or tablet or computer or both, and they go online and do all kinds of fun things. So I'd like to just go through some cybersecurity do's and don'ts that will be useful for you over time. And there's five areas I'll break that down into. I'm going to talk about use of Wi-Fi, passwords, something called credit freeze, and then backing up data, just a word on that. And then finally, we'll talk about social media and privacy. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started with that. I'm going to try to do this all in one take, so hopefully it'll be interesting for you. Okay, and those of you in personal finance, you may have a handout that you could read from. But anyway, with Wi-Fi, we talk about e-commerce. What do we mean by e-commerce? E-commerce means doing business on the web. And this could be Amazon, this could be your bank, this could be anything that deals with your money and buying things or selling things or dealing with your money on the internet, okay? So here's the do's and don'ts. Never conduct e-commerce, that is online banking or purchasing, using Wi-Fi that is not your own, that is in your house or whatever, or at your folks or grandparents or whatever, or at the place of somebody you know, like your sister-in-law. You know, probably you could trust their Wi-Fi. If in doubt, use mobile data. Okay, so here's the deal. You're sitting in, let's just say, Starbucks, probably the best example. And you're surfing the web, you're just looking stuff up and Googling stuff, and all of a sudden you remember you have to transfer money, or you wanted to go on Amazon or Victoria's Secret or whatever and buy something. Do not use their Wi-Fi, because the person sitting across from you is reading and following, or has the potential to pick up your passwords and bank account numbers, all that stuff, through the air, okay? You get what I'm saying. So what you do is you take a second and you switch off the Wi-Fi on your phone or whatever, and you hit the tower, because they can't sniff that, okay, the person sitting next to you. Once you go out to the tower, it's more secure. So you go ahead and do your Amazon or whatever, and then if you don't want to use that, if you'd rather use the Starbucks Wi-Fi after that, then you log out, go back to the Starbucks Wi-Fi, and then you continue. So that's number one. That's the best advice I can give you about Wi-Fi, is unless you know it and trust it, if it's yours or, you know, you're at somebody's house that you know, don't conduct business on that. All right, next one I want to talk about, passwords. Okay, probably you have a router. It came with a default password, or other equipment that you have, even sometimes an account that you set up will have a default password, will have a password that it comes with, okay? Well, everybody knows what that password is, so you need to change that password. So always change default passwords. Another thing is, don't use the same password everywhere. I know it's a lot easier to remember. There's apps out there like LastPass, where it will store your passwords. Even you may just have a really good memory or whatever the case may be. But if you use, let's say, if your password is Jefferson, let's just say, okay, and you use that everywhere, if somebody hacks or finds a way to get into that, you've lost that account. a bank account or Amazon or whatever. But not only that, what's worse than that is then they can use your email address and go to other places that they think you might be doing business with your email address and that password and try it, and they have nothing to lose, and you have a lot to lose. So when you're creating passwords, one of the things I like to do is always use a capital letter. So if your password, let's just say, is Jefferson, make it a capital J, okay? And put a number on the end. So lowercase Jefferson, it's a dictionary word. People could, you know, Mooresville, whatever, people can guess that, or they have computer programs that will just cycle through a whole dictionary and try to hack your hack into it. If you use an uppercase letter somewhere in there, and or, especially and, a number at the end, just the number Jefferson 13, capital J, Jefferson 13, that is infinitely more secure than just the lowercase word. And even if you need to spell it wrong, you're better off than spelling it right. And don't use obvious passwords. I mean, don't use Mooresville. You know, don't use your name, any information like that. And we talk about social media privacy. That's even more important, because if somebody can find your date of birth, or they can find other information about you, all the stuff you have on Facebook, maybe, you know, your girlfriend's name, boyfriend's name, whatever, stuff like that, they could try to use that to hack into other accounts. Okay, number three, credit freeze. And that becomes more important as you have credit, as you borrow money and pay it back. You have your credit rating, credit score. That's a separate topic. I'm not going to talk about that right now, but basically there are three agencies that maintain your credit score. Okay, one or more of the three. You may have heard of them. Experian, TransUnion, and Equifax. Those are not government agencies. These are private, for-profit companies. No one knows why there's three now. And so every time you make a payment, or worse, miss a payment, that gets reported to one or more of these credit agencies. And if you go into, let's say, Greg Hubler Chevrolet, and you want to buy a car and you want to take out a car loan, they will ping one or more of those three credit agencies to get your credit score and find out about your credit history. So what that means is, if somebody hacks into something that you have and they want to borrow money in your name, they've hacked in and they've got your name and they got your email address and they got your date of birth and other information that they might need, and they want to set up this is identity theft, basically. Okay, what they need to do then, the next step, is to say, okay, I'm you, okay, and what I'm going to do now is apply for credit, and it's going to hit one of these credit agencies, and they will say whether you're credit worthy or not. And if you are in the slightest, they will be able to borrow that money, and then you're screwed. And then, you know, you got to go to the Federal Trade Commission and the Mooresville Police and everything, try to get it straightened out. I hear it's a nightmare, and I hope it doesn't happen to anybody. So what you can do, it used to be free in Indiana. Now I think there's a federal law, it's free everywhere. You can place a credit freeze on one or more, and you might as well do all three, of these credit granting agencies. You place a credit freeze. What does that mean? That means when the bad guy goes to get credit using your information, it's locked. They can't get in there. So if they go, let's say, to the Chevy dealer or something, and they want to borrow money in your name, and they go look it up, they say, well, there's a credit freeze here. Can you unlock it for me? Well, of course, they can't unlock it. You'll get a PIN number from each one of those three credit agencies, and this doesn't cost you anything to set up or to open. And with that PIN, you can say, okay, I'm going now, I need to borrow money for a car or a college loan, whatever it is. And so you'll go to the bank and you'll tell, oh, by the way, I have a credit freeze on one or more of my of those three agencies. And so you'll step away, get on your phone, call them up, or get on their website. Using that PIN, which I hope you don't share with anybody, you can then unlock your credit for like 10 days. And that's long enough for somebody to do a real credit search, at which point the door will close and you'll be safe again. So that's just a little something. Credit freeze. Okay. If you have any questions on any of this, you can email me, text me, call me, or whatever when I get back, or, you know, ask one of the staff to get a hold of me, and I'll be happy to answer any questions, general or specific questions. Was not able to do like a webinar today, so we could be more interactive. All right, let's move on. We're almost done. Backing up data. As time goes on, let's say you go out and you go to the library and they do your 2018 taxes now, or you have other documents. Nowadays, a lot of that information you will get emailed to you as a PDF, and you have that PDF file. Other things, medical records, medical and dental records, financial records, tax records, anything like that. Maybe educate your transcript or something. You'll have it as a PDF. I hope you don't want to go through life with a whole bunch of file folders like we used to have to do, okay? So nowadays, the good news is you can put it on a thumb drive. You can put that information on a thumb drive and have it. And so as you go through life, you will have all of your important financial records and everything in one place. Don't lose it. Know where it is. You know, don't take it with you around all the time, especially if you're a person that loses stuff. And you get it. Back up your data. So you may have information on your phone. Photos, too. Photos and videos that you've taken. Things happen, like with Facebook. It would say, oh, it's all out there on Facebook. I wouldn't trust them personally to not lose stuff or delete. I've heard horror stories. You have choices like Google, the cloud, other thing, iCloud for Apple, Amazon photos, stuff like that. So either have things backed up in the cloud or here or both. I'd be a little sensitive about backing up like things like tax records on in a cloud. I don't know how private it would be, but if you tend to lose things, you're probably better off on the cloud with that. So, okay, just, you know, have this somewhere where you can find it again. Okay, last one. Social media privacy. There is none, okay? Basically, you have, I go out to friends' pages. Here, the best example is like my birthday. I use my birthday, is easy to remember. It's December 7th, it's Pearl Harbor Day, 1941. December 7th is not my birthday, but if you go to Facebook, that's my birthday. It's wonderful for your friends to recognize your birthday and tell you happy birthday. That means anybody in the dark web, in Zaire, in Bulgaria, in France, or whatever, now they have your date of birth. Pick up the phone and call your doctor's office, and they want to know it's you, they're going to ask you for your date of birth. That's a nice piece of information to give to the whole world, okay? I don't think so. So that's one big information there. Other information, too, just be careful what you share. The latest scam, and I see intelligent people do this, is these things on Facebook, the little tests, name tests, and there's another one, lopsided. It's like if you want to know, if you absolutely positively have to know what you would look like as a giraffe in 20 years, go play those stupid games. Let me tell you, Google those games, name tests and lopsided. Those, again, I make a joke about somebody in Bulgaria buying that information. It's not a joke. It's true. It's real. That information is sold on the internet. So you go in there and you're like, oh, big deal. I'll be, you know, I'm going to look like a hippopotamus in 20 years. Ha ha, everybody thinks that's funny. All of your information, your date of birth, where you live, where you went to school, everything, all the information that you have. Facebook is not there to make happy cat videos. Facebook is there to make people very, very wealthy by selling all of the information that you put on Facebook. And it's not just Facebook, Instagram, everybody, selling that information. That's how they make money, okay? So you decide how much of that nonsense you want to put out there and how much fun is worth having your entire identity stolen. So I feel like I'm preaching to the choir here or whatever. Anyway, that's it. That's cybersecurity. For those of you in the personal finance class, you're one click closer to getting that credit. And for everybody else, I hope you learned something. I hope you have some questions. Otherwise, we'll see you as soon as we can. Probably be back next week. Personal finance will be on Tuesday, not Monday. That should pretty much do it for this family time. And I'll turn it over to the staff. Take care.